Hey everybody, it's Dr. Michael here. Listen, I'm holed up in my bedroom right now because I didn't want Mr. Whiteboard to hear me. Because those of you watching and listening are probably familiar with Mr. Whiteboard. We've seen him a couple of times. I told him I didn't think we might need him this episode. I wasn't 100% sure, but I'm not sure how well he took it. So I want to kind of explore that with you before I make my final decision. For those of you not watching on YouTube, you want to jump onto YouTube with the link in the description on the podcast so that you can see. But anyway, come follow me. Let's go see what he's looking like. Well, maybe I can use him this time. So before we start the episode and get Mr. Whiteboard involved, poor guy, you could see how he felt about not being included. But we're going to be talking about creatine as a supplement to help persons with Parkinson's disease, potentially. And primarily, we're going to be talking about how creatine could help with mitochondrial health, reducing oxidative stress that could in turn result in improvement in Parkinson's symptoms. Does the research play out to show that that's the case? You'll have to stick around to find out. 3, 2, 1, and... Welcome to the Parkinson's Disease Education Show, where we demystify the disease and empower you as the person with Parkinson's disease to reach your true potential. The content contained on this show is for informational purposes only and is not meant to be a replacement for information or advice that you receive from your in-person medical or therapy professionals. If you haven't already, I hope you'll consider subscribing. And for an even more personalized experience, please ask us about our memberships. Now, without further ado, let's start the show. As we get started talking about creatine, I actually kind of noticed something feels a little bit different now. I'm not exactly sure what it is, but maybe you can let me know in the comments if you notice a difference in anything in my environment. By the way, I also have to say, no whiteboards were harmed in the filming of this video, even though I did have to fix Mr. Whiteboard's face here, as you can see. But don't worry, he'll be back. Seriously though, I really do need to have this blank so that I can show you just a little bit about some of the chemistry going on here as we talk about creatine. So here's some facts about creatine that you might need to know just to understand a little bit more about the chemical molecule that we're talking about, as well as how it could play a role in helping with Parkinson's symptoms, whether it does or not. That's going to be what we're going to talk about a little bit closer to the end of the video, but I want to talk about a little bit of the processes that are behind it first. So before we go on, I just want you to understand a few brief facts about creatine. So creatine is a natural substance that the body uses and is found mostly in the form of phosphocreatine. So it's basically the creatine molecule bonded with phosphorus. And as you'll see when I go to the whiteboard in just a minute, phosphocreatine helps directly with helping the body to get energy, and there's a specific process that goes into that. And of course, so in that sense, creatine is found in the cells, but primarily it's found stored in muscle cells or muscle tissue. 95% in fact is found in the muscle throughout the body, with the remaining 5% being in a couple other areas that aren't really that important to go into at this moment. But 95% is a big amount, so is definitely used by your muscles, and I think you'll see why once we get to the whiteboard. So you notice I have glasses on now because I take them off sometimes if I have them on because of the glare, but I turned my lighting down just a little bit so it doesn't reflect off of the board either. So when we talk about adenosine triphosphate or ATP, remember ATP, think of it as the currency of the cell or the money that you use for energy throughout your body. So ATP, whenever our body uses it for energy, let's say it's to contract a muscle or to breathe or to use your brain, whatever the ATP is being used for in consuming energy, ATP goes from adenosine triphosphate to adenosine diphosphate. So what happens is you get ATP is being used, and then that goes into ADP plus an inorganic phosphate. So basically, chemically speaking, in the cell, in the cytoplasm, you'll have a process where phosphate and creatine are separated from each other. Just kidding. But anyway, that free phosphate is now an inorganic phosphate, PI, and that can then bond with ADP and form another ATP. Now, of course, this is happening on a much bigger scale than just one-to-one, but just understand that that process is happening throughout the cell over and over and over again as you're needing more energy to do cellular processes. So it goes to show that the more creatine you have available, or phosphocreatine, the more easily this process can happen, because you have plenty of free phosphate phosphate with creatine able to be liberated to help form more ATP for energy expenditure. Hope that helped. Well, to do this video, I had to fix Mr. Whiteboard's face, so I suppose I should let him have it back once I adjust this a little bit. Yeah, I suppose I should tell him he could come back now. Oh, there you are. Well, welcome back. He's a great companion. He's really helpful. He's a little bit cheesy. All right, it's time you go. I know the whiteboard thing's cheesy, but I'm having fun with it, so whatever. Anyway, so as far as creatine, the form you tend to find it in as far as a supplement is creatine monohydrate. And of course, it's readily available as a supplement over the counter. Let me go back to the research just for a second. So here's my one beef with the research that's been done as far as it pertains to Parkinson's specifically. Now, I mentioned there's been some randomized controlled trials, some clinical trials, and there's a meta-analysis that was done in 2017 that kind of looked at the results of all those trials and kind of put it all together and spit it out and says, okay, what does this tell us? Well, they did the Universal Parkinson's Disease Rating Scale, which has several tiers. There's mental, there's motor, etc. They also looked at ADLs, or activities of daily living, and then there was a Schwab, England Schwab, and I'm sorry, I forgot the whole name of the scale, but there's several different scales they used, but that included the UPDRS. And the UPDRS scores did not change significantly between those that had control that didn't take creatine and those that did take creatine as a supplement. Same thing went with ADL improvements. My problem is the UPDRS is a rating scale of Parkinson's symptoms, and I'm not saying that's not what we're trying to target with talking about this subject, but I would argue that those that have benefits from creatine may not be seeing it in motor symptoms, or they may not be seeing it so much in their cognition. Maybe they're seeing it improvements in other non-motor symptoms. For example, fatigue or sleep problems. I'm not sure. I don't think those studies exist at this point. However, I think that's an area for further research we really need to advocate for. And also the scales that we use matter. So I think the PDQ-39 would be an even better scale to use, because that's a quality of life measure. So I'm not saying it's not, the UPDRS is important, but the PDQ-39 would be a great way to assess how people are feeling about their life living with Parkinson's compared to before they took some of these supplements. That would tell a lot, because if we're helping mitochondrial health, if we're helping to reduce oxidative stress or the effects of oxidative stress, that's going to naturally improve your energy levels. It's going to reduce inflammation in your body, and that could help in an indirect way your Parkinson's symptoms, or maybe even in a direct way if it's improving the function of the nerve cells that produce dopamine. I did look it up, by the way. It's the Schwab and England scale for activities of daily living. That was bothering me. I had to look it up. And so I looked at the PDQ-39 to give you a little bit more of an idea of kind of what's assessed on that. And this is a self-assessment questionnaire. So this isn't something a clinician is looking at. This is something that they would have you fill out as a person with Parkinson's. And they're looking at activities of daily living, attention and working memory, cognition, communication, depression, functional mobility, quality of life, social relationships, and social support. So that's a pretty broad, well, there's some specific detailed areas, but that's a big, I guess, holistic approach is what I'm trying to get at for looking at kind of your experience living with Parkinson's. And if those things change, because of supplements that we're taking, then that's something that's important to know, and that's something that's scientifically important. And that's why I've argued for the fact that we need more research in these areas, because the research that we have is very limited, and I don't think the studies have always been designed very well from what I'm reading. But again, if you feel like it helps you, and again, kind of like with CoQ10, if it helps your mitochondrial health, if it helps to reduce oxidative stress, in some ways, it might help you feel better. And so I think it's worth taking it as a supplement to boost what you're doing to make yourself healthy. Even if it doesn't specifically address Parkinson's symptoms, it's not a bad thing to do all around. So as before, I'll leave a link in the description and a card above so that you can access a version of creatine monohydrate as a supplement. You can find them on Amazon or local places. But of course, Amazon is pretty easy. As always, thank you so much for watching. If you're still here with me in this part of the video, I do want to encourage you, if you're listening to this as an audio podcast, I'd love for you to follow the show. And if you're on YouTube, please subscribe, like the video. Let me know in the comments below, if you're on YouTube, what you thought about this and what your experience possibly has been taking creatine as a supplement along with the other ways that you treat Parkinson's disease. And I think that would be valuable for everybody else who's watching and listening. Until next time, be empowered. I look forward to seeing you again.